بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، أما بعد. We'll continue the wasaya for life and the last wasiya, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Abi Huraira, and the part that we are studying, love for people what you love for yourself, you'll be a Muslim. And usually people take lightly this hadith or the other hadith that the Prophet ﷺ, one will not be a believer till he or she loves for his brother or her sister, you know, what they love for themselves. The main, you know, way how to understand this hadith is first to look at the rights of the Muslims or the believers that they are on you, the right toward each other. And when we look at this right, we find them is all adab, behavior, conduct, etiquette. And the adab in general are the akhlaq, in the akhlaq. Therefore, let's put it in another way, as we have said, you know, deal with people, treat people the way you want to be treated. That's how you can attain to love other, the way you love yourself, or to love for other what you love for yourself. And the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, introduced a lot of etiquette and behavior that upon every one of us need to try to observe all of them. We'll continue with this etiquette, with this behavior that helping one to attain the level of loving for other what he or she loves for herself. The nasiha. The advice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in hadith of Tamim al-Dari, qala ad-dinu an-nasiha. Ad-dinu an-nasihatu. Religion, or the path of the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an-nasihatu. An-nasihatu is the advice. And an-nasihatu also has another meaning, which is al-ikhlasu, sincerity. So understanding the advice is understanding it through the sincerity. Because when you want to advise someone, you advise them with sincerity, which is mean seeking for them the good for themselves, as first you have to advise yourself before advising other. If that issue that you're going to advise other to stop doing it or to observe it, one has to call himself or herself or accountable for such a thing. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "الدينُ النصيحة ثلاثاً قلنا لمن," he said, "To whom, يا رسول الله?" To whom this advice should be addressed? قال لله ولكتابه ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. And another, he's mentioned here the narration, omitting the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال لله ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. To whom, ya Rasulullah, this advice need to be addressed? The Prophet ﷺ said, to Allah, to his messenger, to his book, to the leaders of the Muslim, and to the mass or the general of the Muslim. As we said, an-nasiha to eat the sincerity, then what does it mean to address your advice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be sincere in your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by fulfilling and submitting to his way. To his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow his footsteps and teaching, which teaching the only way to help you and guide you toward the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the same for his book. For a'immatil muslimina is to advise them sincerely to follow the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so they can do justice into the way or in the responsibility that they had. And then they will help, you know, in the best of their ability, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers, وَعَمَّتِهِمْ, and all the believers, to enjoy good and forbid evil. عن جرير ابن عبد الله قال بايعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على إقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة والنصح لكل مسلم. Every companion before, when they come to accept Islam, they give their pledge to the Prophet ﷺ. And the pledge is the commitment. The pledge is the oath to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be witnessing on that pledge if they have done it. So he said, I gave my pledge and oath to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to establish the prayer and pay the zakat and make nush li kulli Muslim, to be true to every Muslim by doing the right advice, to not be hypocrite, to not be wishy-washy, to not say things that I do not intend, to not let someone be deluded by saying, what do you think? I say, it's great. And as soon as the person turned, he said, you know, that really looks bad. So to be sincere, that's the nasiha. If someone asks you for nasiha, be sincere. And that's the true nasiha. Not sincere for yourself. You do not hear in the nasiha that you're going to give your own opinion, and your own taste, because your own taste may not be the same taste of your brother. The nasiha in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has unanimous way and unanimous opinion and very clear, you know, steps that you go the nasiha to. If you see something wrong or something that you've been asked to say, you say it right in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with kindness and with right etiquette. عن أنس قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قضى لأحد من أمتي حاجة يريد أن ييسره بها فقد سرني. Whoever who helped one from my ummah in any of the challenges or issues or difficulties that he going through or she's going through, seeking to make it easy for them, seeking to make it easy for them, he's indeed قد سرني. Sarani, which is mean make me happy, make me joyful. He's really, you know, the Prophet ﷺ likes such a thing. And whoever who will have to be, you know, doing such a thing and convey such a thing to the Prophet ﷺ, then the same he will do it for Allah. Because if you do good thing to the Prophet, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes that. قال ومن سر الله أدخله الجنة. And if you convey such a thing and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be happy with you, then he will admit you into paradise. And this is look the chain by just seeking with sincerity to help one of your brother or sister make things easy for them. And this is from باب النصيحة. وعنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أغاث ملهوفا كتب الله ثلاثة وسبعين مغفرة. Whoever one who's in need, in difficulty, you know, going through issues, and he's been helped, whoever helped him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever helped her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inscribed for them 70 forgiveness. And he called, when we say forgiveness, we don't know what the meaning of forgiveness. We know raising the sins, but the 70 forgiveness here, قال 73 forgiveness, واحدة فيها صلاح أمره كله. One of them, one only, one them, enough by correcting all his or her way in this life. One. And 72 will be ranks to him or to her in the hereafter. وعنه عن عبد الله قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الخلق عيال الله فأحب الخلق إلى الله من أحسن إلى عياله فأحب الخلق إلى الله من أحسن إلى عياله. And this is hadith رواه البيهقي. The creation of Allah is like the children of Allah. The children as a way to say it that Allah care about them, provide for them, cherish them. Whoever then take care of them, of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and be kind to them, nice to them, Allah will be kind and nice to the one who take care of his iyal. Also from the etiquette, so all of this what we are talking about, not only that every believer need to observe it, but also to put in your mind that you want other to do it for you. And that's how we love for other, for what you love for yourself. If you want to give nasiha then open your heart for the nasiha. Okay? If you are in difficulty and wish people to help you, then also when someone in difficulty, you raise to help them. And that is the effect or the implementation of the hadith. Not as we said, and again we emphasize on it, it's not about things. If you have a nice thing in your hand, you love it for your brother to have it, or you have a nice car, you want your brother to have it like you love it, it's not restricted to toys or to materialistic thing. It is extended to all the type of the behavior and the etiquette. So truly to love for someone what you love for yourself, you have first to observe all the great etiquette of a Muslim, then how that's the way you'll be able to fulfill it. قال أن تعود مرضى المسلمين مع مراعاة آداب زيارة. One of the other etiquette is to visit the sick among the Muslims. And while visiting, one has to observe the etiquette of visiting the sick people. خفة الجلسة وقلة السؤال وإظهار الرقة والدعاء بالعافية وغض البصر عن عورات الموضة. And this is, subhanAllah, etiquette that we need to revive, especially in this society. Many of you, mashallah, they do it, you know, spontaneously. But by reminding each other about it, then we realize these are from etiquette of Islam, because the great thing about our path is to connect this etiquette to your own natural disposition. Things, you know, opposite to this are add to the natural disposition and is not part of the morality of Islam. So what are these things? If someone was visit the sick, khiffatul jalsa, to be very light, which is mean he's not going to stay there, he's going to say, I'm going to have stay the whole evening, I have a friend who is sick, I'm going to, you know, have my evening there. That's not right. Khiffa, very light, which is mean very short. قِلَّةُ السُّؤَالِ, do not ask much. You know, what happened, how did you do get this, do you have this in the family? لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا خُدْ, I mean, خِفَّةُ السُّؤَالِ, قِلَّةُ السُّؤَالِ, how is everything? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, or going through like, you know, how much did you see the doctor? Those doctor, who's tell me who's the name, I will tell you are good or bad. You know, there's people sometimes they get into a discussion, they really hurting the person instead of bringing hope, bringing, you know, boost of moral to this person. This person was sick, he wished for that person to leave right away. So, خِفَّةُ الْجَلْسَة, to be very short, قِلَّةُ السُّؤَال, to really do not ask much, except, you know, the requirement to show that you are concerned. إِظْهَارُ الرَّقَّة, to show the rahmah, to show that subhanallah, humbleness, that you care about your brother or your sister, والدعاء بالعافية, and to make the dua for ease and for the healing and the speed recovery. Now the next one, وغض البصر عن عورات الموضة, and to lower your gaze when you are in the place. To lower your gaze, to not see, I mean not lowering the gaze on the people in the family, lower your gaze on the place. Don't try to look what type of TV that they have, what big it is, what type of thing that they have looking, you know, that subhanAllah is like making inventory, that's haram. Lower your gaze. عن الموضع. وعند الاستئذان لا يقابل الباب بوجهه. And when he knocks at the door to take in the permission, he should not stand face the door. Why? Because the person, maybe one of the kids, is going to open the door. And someone behind the door, he's not ready to welcome people. Maybe there's a sister with no hijab, things. So you need to be on the side of the door. So when it opens the door, he will sight will be totally opposite to the door. You see the etiquette? قَالَ لَا يُقَابِبُ الْبَابَ بِوَجْهِ وَيَدُقُّ بِرِفْقٍ. And he will knock with very lightly, soft. That people like making, you know, Sometimes people run, they knock the door, you see like there is police outside or something. وَلَا يَقُولُ أَنَا إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ مَنْ وَلَا يَقُولُ يَا غُلَامُ. He will not say, for example, you knock the door, people, they say, who's at the door? You say, me. Don't say me. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam disliked to say me. Say your name. It's like me. Who are you? You know, there's people, me. We get used to it. وَلَا يَقُولُ يَا غُلَامُ. He said he should not say kid, you know, things like, you know. وَلَكِنْ يَحْمَدْ وَيُسَبِّحْ. He will say, you know, جَزَكُمْ اللَّهِ خَيْرًا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ, things like that. وَحَسْبُكَ قَوْلُ الرَّسُولِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَنْ عَادَ مَرِيذًا قَعَدَ فِي مَخَارِفِ الْجَنَّةِ حَتَّى إِذَا قَامْ وَكُلُّ وُكِّلَ بِهِ 70,000 ملك يُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى اللَّيْلِ. This hadith, رواه أصحاب السنن. الله. He said, who go visit a sick person with observing this etiquette, he's like he'd in the meadows of paradise. And 70,000 angels will be assigned to this person, making istighfar to this person the whole evening. وقوله إذا عاد الرجل المريض خاض في الرحمة فإذا قعد عنده قرت فيه. When someone goes to visit a sick, he's like, subhanAllah, get into, fully into the rahmah of Allah. When he sit by him, the rahmah get inside that person. ثم أنت وفي عيادة المريض إذا رأيت عنده استعدادا لوقع كلامك يحسن أن تبشره. If you see the person like he want to talk to you, then give him a glad tidings, you know. And there's people, subhanAllah, and this is a true story, which is, I heard it from one of the shiur. Someone want to visit a sick person. So when he enter, this person is tall. When he enter, he has to go down because the door was. So he said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heal you. May Allah, that person feel good. Then when he left, he hit his head on the door. He said, it's too low. How are they going to get the coffin out from here? So he's already, look at what he said and what in his mind. It's like this person dead and already they're going to take him out. How are they going to get him out? And this is not only he ruined the rahmah that he get, but he's a rude person who does not have mindful of the situation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from ill manners and from unmindfulness to cause hurting for people who are supposed to bring rahmah with you to them. Qala, and be like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tubashirhu biqawli Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may yuridillahu bi khayran yusib minhu. Said, who Allah want good for him, he will put him into trial. Like you're being sick. وعوذه بما عوذ به الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنه عندما عاده وقد كان مريضا فقال بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أعوذك بالله الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد من شر ما تجد. This is what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to عثمان. قالها مرارا, he said it many times. ودخل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على علي ابن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه وهو مريض. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم visited علي رضي الله تعالى عنه and he was sick. فقال له قل اللهم إني أسألك تعجيل عافيتك. Oh Allah, I ask you to hasten and speed up my recovery. أو صبرا على بليتك. Or a patience on this trial. أو خروجا من الدنيا إلى رحمتك. Or leaving this dunya to your mercy, ya Allah. فإنك ستعطى إحداهن. You're going to get one of them. Speed up recovery. If that's in the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no speed up of recovery. There is no recovery. Ya Allah, give me patience. If this disease is going to lead to death, ya Allah, take me to your mercy. Subhanallah. Yeah? سبحان الله. قال تعجيل عافيتك أو صبرا على بليتك أو خروجا من الدنيا إلى رحمتك. And this is the truly submission. This is what it means to make istislam lillah. Because you don't know what is good for you. It might be death is the good for you. It might be the recovery, the speed recovery is good for you. It might be you need, you know, longer time of being in bed for you to reflect. Then you ask the sabr. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, whatever has been decreed to you, Allah will give it to you. Because if it's long trial, what is the solution? Is the sabr. If leaving this dunya, what is the great reward? Is the rahmah. If someone, there is afiyah, Allah decreed that you're going to be healed, then what is the best thing? Is to speed up the recovery. Also from the etiquette is tashi'ul janaiz. From the etiquette, from the adab, tashi'ul janaiz is to go in the funeral. Because, subhanallah, the better you go in your life with people, the more people you have in your janaiz, the more people make dua for you. The more people make dua for you, the more likely to be in the, admitted in the mercy of Allah. Wallahi, there is a story. Someone in al-haram, they get a group, they made the salah on them. And then, as soon as they finish, one subhanallah came. They said, you know, this. So the imam wait. And then the whole people in the haram, in hajj time, imagine hajj time how full. They make salat for that person. So it was a group, and then salat for this person by himself. And then, subhanAllah, there is another one. All the salat finished, prayed on him. The imam, he didn't pray because he left. Prayed on him, the people who brought him, and that's it. There were like maybe five, six people in the haram. Just you see the opportunities of the rahmah. You see the opportunities of rahmah. And the more you see the opportunity, if you were in Umrah and Hajj, because they pray Salatul Janazah almost every prayer, especially in Al Haram and Mecca. There is people sometimes they'd be tired, you know, they will, but sometimes subhanAllah you feel that you are making a lot of dua. It's like, subhanAllah, Allah loves this person that people are praying for. For this is important to be regarded. Because one of the great things that you can offer to yourself is your kindness to the people to remember you when you die. Because you need that dua. And whoever who will go, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, قال whoever who witness a janazah and stand on it till it fully buried, he will have two qiratan. Qiratan, it's a big amount of hasanat, of good deeds. When the Prophet ﷺ was asked about the qira, he said the size of the Jabal Uhud. And Jabal Uhud is the chain of the mountains that you see in Medina, in Uhud. Now, what it means to go into funeral, it's a good etiquette for us to learn. It's not just to go with an empty heart. First, this is the rights of the Muslim on you. That's one thing. The second, al-i'tibar, to reflect, to take a lesson. And the great lesson that all of us we had, and we still, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us firmness and shower with His mercy those that Allah chose to take. Allahumma ameen. وَتَرْقِيقُ الْقَلْبِ مَعَى لُزُومِ الْخُشُوعِ to have softened the heart with the devotion and humility. Because the one who does not find humility in the graveyard, then know, O brother or sister, that your heart is dead. And if someone dies in a state of a dead, of a heart dead, what does he have to present? We're going to see the hadith. وَتَرْكُ الْحَدِيثِ Do not speak, especially not speak about dunya. Sometimes you witness people around the grave and they're talking about, you know, business, and they talking and laughing. وَمُلَاحَظَةُ الْمَيِّتِ And to look and observe the dead person. وَالتَّفْكِيرُ فِي الْمَوْتِ And to remember death. وَالْإِسْتَعْدَادِ لَهِ And to get ready for it. وَالْمَشْيُ أَمَامَ الْجَنَازَةِ وَبِقُرْبِهَا That the mashi is either to walk in front of it or on the side. And also to visit the qubur of al-Muslimin, to make dua for them, and to for you to be inspired to the point that you seek in, you know, a softness into your heart and remembering your end. Remembering your end. We live in a society, wherever you look around you is immortal. People are engorging themselves and accumulating. It's like that no one of them is going to die. So we've been contaminated by such things. So if you do not think that you're going to end at any time, does not mean that you fill yourself with despair that you do not live, but you're going to die. Are you ready? ففي الحديث ما شريف الحديث ما رأيت منظرا إلا والقبر أفضع منه. I didn't see any scene that can be compared to the grave. The grave is something that is the greatest in the reminder, because you're gonna be there. You're gonna be there. يقول عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه خرجنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأتى المقابر فجلس إلى قبر وكنت أدنى القوم منه فبكى وبكينا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, we came around the graveyard and he was close to one of them and he started to cry. All of us, we cried because he was crying. Then he said, why are you crying? قالوا نبكي لبكائك يا رسول الله. You are crying because you are crying. قال هذا قبر آمنة بنت وهب. This is the grave of آمنة, my mother, بنت وهب. استأذنت ربي في زيارتها فأذن لي. I get, you know, I ask, I requested the permission from Allah to visit her grave. He gave me the permission. And I requested the permission to ask forgiveness for her. Allah refused. فَأَدْرَكَنِي مَا يُدْرِكُ الْوَلَدُ مِنَ الرِّقَّةِ So I get what the child will have from riqqa, from softness, from longing to have what he has to his mother. And this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Say alhamdulillah for everyone, dear one, that we have lost. You can say, Ya Allah, forgive them. Ya Allah, forgive them. وكان عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه إذا وقف على قبر يبكي حتى تبل لحيته حتى تبل لحيته. عمر, when he stands by a grave, subhanAllah, he will cry till his beard with soaked with his tears. And he say, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Inna al-qabr awwal manazil al-akhirah." The qabr is the first position, is the first step in the hereafter. فَإِن نَجَى مِنْهُ صَاحِبُهُ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَيْسَرُ If someone, subhanAllah, is saved from the grave, everything else after it is going to be easy. وَإِن لَمْ يَنْجُو مِنْهُ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَشَدُ If he will not be saved from the grave, whatever after it is going to be more grievous. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ It was narrated in Al-Khabar أن أول ما يكلم ابن آدم حفرته. It was narrated that the first thing that will address to the child of Adam is the grave. The grave will be saying, أنا بيت الدود وبيت الوحدة وبيت الغربة وبيت الظلمة. I'm the home of worms, of loneliness, of الغربة. الغربة to be stranger, the strange home, or things like that, you know, the lonely home, and the home of darkness. What have you prepared for me? That's why from the wasaya of Abi Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, I took from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the same narrated by Abu Huraira, he said, to pray two rak'ah in the heart of the night to illuminate the darkness in the grave. So this is the place. What have you prepared for it? All what we have, wallah, the rahmah of Allah. We have the rahmah of Allah. What we have prepared, wallah, the rahmah of Allah. We are not able to be, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us in his rahmah. يقول أبو ذر لأصحابي ألا أخبركم بيوم فقري. Should I tell you the day of my فقري is like my poverty when I become fully poor. قال I mean I will not have anything. They told him yes. He said the day when I be put in my grave. وكان أبو الدرداء يقعد إلى القبور فقيل له في ذلك فقال أجلس إلى قوم يذكرونني معادي وإن قمت عنهم لم يغتابوني. They ask Abu Darda, why you sit, you know, always around the graveyard? He said, I sit with people, they remind me my day. And when I leave them, they do not backbite me. Great wisdom. وقال حاتم الأصم. We have a good, great relation with حاتم, the one who taught us those six, you know, great gems that he learned from his Shaykh Shakhiq al-Balkhi. قال من مر بالمقابر فلم يتفكر لنفسه ولم يدعو لهم فقد خان نفسه وخانهم. Whoever who passed by the graveyard and he will not think of himself or herself and do not make dua and does not make dua for them, he betrayed himself and he betrayed them, because it's right. So your brother or your sister who passed away, is their right on you to make dua as you wish. You see that when you go from this dunya, people to make dua for you, you do the same for your brothers and sisters, dear one who left us. وقال سفيان من أكثر ذكر القلب وجده روضة من رياض الجنة. Whoever who remember much the grave, he will find it a meadow of paradise. And the one who's totally heedless of it, he going to find it a pit of fire. Wallahi, this Imam Sufyan al-Thawri telling you something great wisdom. Of course, someone who does not even think of his death. What does it mean? That is someone off the path. How are you going to find this grave? You're going to find it a pit of fire, wal-iyadh billah. But if you're always mindful of it and you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking refuge from adab al-qabr in your salat, when you go to sleep and think, then your qabr is going to be rawda min riyad al-jannah, is a garden of paradise. So you see, we have the keys. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to get the right key. وَكَانَ الرَّبِيعُ ابْنُ خَيْثٍ قَدْ حَفَرَ فِي دَارِهِ قَبْرًا. Rabi' ibn al-Khaytham, in his backyard, I mean, in his home, to say, be close. Inshallah, today here, the houses, they have backyard and front yard. So at that time, they might have, you know. But he said, he had in his house a grave. He dig a grave in his house. In one of narration, it was in his small backyard. He has a grave. قال فكان إذا وجد في قلبه قساوة دخل فيه. When his heart grow hard, he feel like, you know, distant from Allah, you know, attached to the dunya. A reminder does not had its in effect in him. What he does, he go in that grave and he lay down. And he stay hours. Then he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِي لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا. Oh Allah, take me back that I might do good this time. And he stands. It's like, subhanAllah, people they act, you know, to subhanAllah, they act as a way of acting, either hypocrisy or to please others. If you do act for yourself, it's like you say, okay, now I am dead, like Rabi' ibn Khaytham. And then you feel that you have this opportunity, a new opportunity in your life. Because when someone is in the grave or someone dying, يقول رب ارجعون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, كلا إنها كلمة هو قائلها. It's a word that everyone is going to say, but there is no way for them to come back. But if you truly have the opportunity to come back as a reminder for yourself, then you see how your heart turned to be soft and to be filled with humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said to himself, يا ربي قد أرجعت فعمل الآن قبل ألا ترجع. Say to yourself, now you have the opportunity to work. And you had the opportunity to come back to the dunya. Now work hard before when it comes the time that you will not be able to come back. That will be the true death. These are, you know, etiquettes and adab that all of us we need to observe. So there is no way truly, and to be frank to each other, to build the unity or the brotherhood or the sisterhood if you do not have this etiquette. If you do not have this akhlaq, if you do not have this behavior, then we cannot, you know, respect each other. Because the base of the respect is the akhlaq. If there's no akhlaq, there's chaos. And this is how saral and subhanAllah, you know, very powerful in any way. That teach us to be humble, teach us to be good people, kind, caring people. The time ended, but I finish with this one. Says Al-Imam Al-Ghazali fi Al-Ihya, this is after all this adab that we have mentioned, there is, you know, comprehensive, you know, principles that will be guide for you in every action you do. لا تستصغر منهم أحدا حيا كان أو ميتا. Do not belittle any one of your brother or sister, alive or dead. فتهلك, then you're going to ruin yourself. Because you do not know. لا تدري لعله خير منك. You don't know the people that you belittle or you look down or you neglect. He might be better than you. Even if he's a bad person and you see him doing bad, he might, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, grant him the gift to die in a state of goodness. And you might die in a state of evil. Do not belittle anybody. Do not look down to anybody. Especially the people that frequent with you the same place. If you're standing together, it make the brother, may the brother that next to you, it can be your bridge to paradise. Don't think that you are better than anybody else. If we have that feeling, then say to yourself, you are the worst of the people. وَلَا تَنْظُرْ إِلَيْهِمْ بِعَيْنِ التَّعْظِيمِ لَهُمْ فِي حَالِ دُنْيَا. If someone has dunya, good, rich, do not look at them with the eye of greatness. So these great people. فَإِنَّ الدُّنْيَا صَغِيرَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. The dunya is nothing in the eye of Allah. So if you glorify people and you venerate them because of what they have from worldly life, then you become small in the eye of Allah. وإن عظم أهل الدنيا في نفسك فقد عظمت الدنيا فتسقط من عين الله. And if the people of the dunya, you see them with the big eye, with the great respect, then the dunya became big into your heart. And you become very small in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us look at people through the way of Allah, make us humble, and Allah cure our heart to not venerate the dunya, nor the people of the dunya, but to respect everyone. For may Allah bestow upon morality, akhlaq and adab, and shower us with taqwa and good behavior. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower with His mercy our dear ones who left us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admit them in the highest of paradise. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not deprive us from their great reward and not put us in a trial after their departure. And may Allah make us to all be gathered in His rahmah in Jannat al-Na'im. برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خير. Any question?